Small introduction about the speaker and for the next workshop. She is Harini Srinivasan. Harini is a senior technical staff member at Weather Company division of IBM Watson. She manages a team of data scientists that brings weather-based solutions to client across multiple industries. She has worked in areas such as social media database-based analytics, analytics for e-commerce environments, performance and analysis of large-scale solutions, and fundamental research in programming languages and runtimes. Along with her, the other speaker we have is Prateep Basu. So Prateep is the founder and global head of strategy and partnerships at SatSure, a spatial data intelligence startup, working on creating sustainable solutions for enabling financial inclusion for farmers in developing countries. He's an aerospace engineer from the IISST Trivandrum with post-graduation in space studies from the International Space University, Salzburg. He has worked as a scientist in ISRO and as a geospatial industry analyst at Boston-based Northern Sky Research. So both of them, they are going to conduct a workshop on imagine the possibilities with weather-based decision-making. So I'll hand it over to Harini, ma'am. Ma'am, if you're ready to go. Thank you. Sure.
Can you hear me? Yeah? The back?
Is it audible, ladies and gentlemen? Would you like to take a mic, sir?
Can you hear me now? Yeah? Okay. So before I start, Hello? Yeah? Is it okay?
Two, check.
Can you hear me now? Okay. I don't know if people know the Verizon ad. If you've seen it, I don't know. I think one or two people have seen it. Okay, so I just want to give the structure of our this 1 hour for the next 1 hour. What we want to do is make it very interactive. So I'm only going to talk for 10 minutes. And then at the end, we have our sponsor, he's here, okay. He's going to talk on how he has used weather data in their solution. But in between, what we want to do is, actually we want to, we will be passing out some flyers on some scenarios or solution areas and some questions around those areas. And we'd like to get your views on how you may be using, how you would think weather can be used, weather data can be used in these solutions. So you can choose one of four scenarios that we present. And yeah, it's more for us to get feedback on how people are thinking about weather data, data scientists and business folks. You know, we have interacted a lot with clients and we're showing how we use weather data too, you know, in our business solutions. And at the end, we hope to give t-shirts to everybody who participated. So that's an incentive for everybody to stay. But really, you know, please don't leave. Please, you know, let's make this interactive. We want to hear you. And we'll be coming around and helping. So without taking more time, this is standard IBM format. We always have to start with a nice video. So here we go.
Thank you.
Okay, so that was actually, this is a product called WeatherFX. It's under the Watson advertising umbrella. And we are all in the Watson Media and Weather division of IBM. So what happens under the cover here is that we are taking volumes of weather data. When I say weather data, it is, we'll talk in detail about what it is, but granular data, daily data in this particular case, there's a data science platform there. That's the middle part here, which identifies, you know, what weather threshold values for every single weather variable that actually impacts the consumer behavior affect consumer behavior. So that data, that result is actually fed into an automated targeting platform, and the client can use that platform to trigger advertisements. And what you saw, you know, in the pictures, all those percentage numbers were actually real from real clients. So so that's one solution. And what I'm going to do in the next two slides is talk about two more case studies where, you know, weather has had an impact. I can go on and on, but I only have 10 minutes. So the other one is taking just the raw weather data, you know, filter to daily, whatever granularity, to filter to a specific lat long or a location, and use that to send out weather alerts. And this was used by one of our transportation clients, the US Night Transportation. What they did is they used this weather data along with telematics and geolocation information to alert their truck drivers of impending, you know, bad weather. And to many of these companies, client, you know, worker satisfaction is extremely important. Their safety is very important. And hence we got this, attestation from the client. They were very happy about this solution. It boosts safety, aids retention, and reduces risk. Now, the third one, this is very close to my heart. I live in New York. This is One World Observatory. It's on the 9/11 Memorial. Many of you may have been there too. And we worked with the parent company called Legends. And what we did there was we took weather data to historic weather data and their sales data, same day ticket sales and also previous sales, to identify the impact of weather, what weather variables actually caused the sales to go up or down. And we also identified the impact on anomalies in their sales. And, you know, the client, of course, they're smart. You know, they reduce the sales or they, in fact, send out messages whenever visibility is low. And they were actually getting this data from another company, just visibility information. What they did not know is that relative humidity was a very big factor in people going to the one OWO. So that made a big difference. We put this in production, and the client was very happy. Not just that, it validated that, yeah, cloud coverage or visibility was a difference, but also the relative humidity was a very important factor in them, you know, receiving a client. And they have their own system to talk to customers who bought their tickets and suggest different times or days based on weather conditions. So those were just three case studies. What I'm going to do now is talk about what drives all this. And for people who were in Himanshu's talk earlier, he talked a lot about, you know, the greatness about our weather data. I might repeat some, so I just reiterate what we told you earlier. So when you check the weather, okay, so when you go to weather.com and check the weather, or Apple, or recently Samsung, Google, Yahoo, you get our weather. And why is it great? Because, you know, it is number one, most accurate weather data. It's not what we define. It's done by ForecastWatch, which is the grand Gartner equivalent in the weather space. So ForecastWatch actually regularly analyzes the forecast data of multiple weather providers, and we are number one consistently to show you the results. This is global metrics. Source is ForecastWatch.com. And these are day 1, 3, day 3, 5, day 6, 9 horizon of our accuracy. And actually, we do much better in Asia than in US, and you will see that, you know, the numbers are not clear. The leftmost is our number, okay? So accuracy is the best with ours. I don't intend you to read each and every number, but the idea is that we are number one in this space. So to go into details, this is the US value, 80.9% accuracy. I'll tell you how we get to this particular forecast in 80.9. For data scientists, you'll realize this is quite a good number, actually. And I also want to point out that there is a big weather science team. In addition to hundreds of meteorologists who are everywhere, including one Manish Modani here, we have many meteorologists. We also have a world-class, you know, a weather science team who publish in all the AMS and IMS conferences. And they are constantly working on improving the forecast. So that's what this chart is trying to show you, that from 2005 to 2017, we have improved accuracy considerably, and we continue to work. Okay, now the second question is, how do we get this accuracy, right? So there are three dimensions to this. One is what data we use. The second dimension is how we do the modeling. And the third one is the scale. So in terms of the data, we aggressively acquire data. Okay, so we aggressively acquire technical terms. We get them from meter stations, airports, wherever we have meter stations all over the world, we get that data. But in addition to that, we collect, tons of data from personal weather stations, airlines, aviation clients give us data because, it gives us atmospheric data from their devices. And we partner with practically all the airlines in the United States and few around the world. And so we happen to get, a lot of data from the atmospheric, side. And the other thing is we also get radar data from many government and institutions around the world that also helps provide this information. And lastly, we also get data from phones because you have the pressure readability within the phones. And so that's another data point that, that is used. The second dimension is how we actually build this. So we call this proudly the Deep Thunder model. And this is a combination, actually, more recently of years of research from IBM Research, math department. They had a big, they have a big meteor, weather sciences team, and TWC Weather Company's weather sciences team. What happens under the cover? We take 162 individual global models. There are lots of global models out there. Most popular of them is ECMWF, and we take all these global models. And then we build a forecast from them. But, and about 26 billion times a day. Okay, so the scale is very, very important here. Because we're able to do this at scale, we can actually predict at 500 by 500 meter accuracy, spatial granularity, and at every 15 minute temporal granularity. So in terms of the model itself, it's a multimodal and ensemble model. It's a little more tricky than just taking multiple models and building an ensemble. Every single weather variable that comes in is weighted. And it's done in real time from every single of these 162 models. It's done in real time. And then the ensembling approach will actually build the final forecast. Okay, so that's at a high level what's happening under the cover to make it very, very deep. And that's why it's Deep Thunder. So, yeah, go ahead. When you call, so we call the models, but they're results from these models. In addition to what we collect, because we want the best accuracy over everything that's out, available out there. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, so each one of them will give you results for every single weather variable. So weather variables can be variations of temperature, different types of dew point, just surface temperature, regular temperature, min-max, average. You have wind speed, wind gust, precipitation, humidity, snowfall, cloud coverage, many.
How do you have the results from those 160 models?
Because they are provided.
How do you arrive at the weights? Because when you develop a model using the results of 160 models, I'm sure that you use some kind of weighting or some.
Yes, that is the statistical piece of information that IP that is sitting inside the Deep Thunder model. Okay.
My question is, do you have difficulties in procuring these many number of data points from specific countries, or do countries have restrictions? I imagine in countries like China and even in India,
we don't get radar data from here, for example. That's a big challenge for us. So that's when the other data sets try to offset from them.
Does that mean like you try to fill in data and make estimations?
Yeah. I mean, it's not like, you know, because we have multiple data sets, they're used to also cross-validate the results. So at the end, you know, what we have is currents on demand. Okay, the forecast on demand is what I was talking about, the forecast, which is the prediction model. Think of the same thing as a nowcast model, is current on demand, some variations here. When we forecast, and this forecast happens for every 15 minutes, we can aggregate a daily, hourly or daily level. And if you want to go to, you know, weekly level at higher granularity space-wise, you know, we have like my team, I have a team of data scientists, I have a meteorologist who knows how to aggregate weather data. You know, we need to do it the right way because it's different, snowfall is different from, you know, temperature. Seasonal and subseasonal is where we give the data only, you know, subseasonal is, you know, 1 to 3 months, seasonal goes up to 7 months. And there, you know, to be very honest, we don't give all the weather variables. It's a challenge, so we only give temperature and precipitation. History on demand is, this is the key for my team, because we actually archive our current on demand data that we'll use for prediction analysis. Okay, so actually this is all I had to talk about, and she's seeing me. I need to give this back to, you know, the exercise part, but I can keep answering questions. In the meantime, I just want to say that we're going to set up the team, the audience here. We have, just to reiterate for people who came late, we have about 4 solution areas in different industries. I hope it'll be fun for you all to do, because this is what I'm looking at almost every day. We get questions from sales or offering, hey, we have a client, can you do this problem for us, solve this problem. And I would like you all to think about them and give you a viewpoint. I'm so excited to do this exercise with you all because I'm sure there are people who think differently than we do. So if you can just, I think they'll help you group the audience into 4 teams, and you can use these whiteboards to discuss, and we have t-shirts for everybody at the end.
Oh, I had one question on your slide number 3, if I'm not wrong. So you had that graph which had US, Europe, and Asia. And you rightly mentioned that Asia, the accuracy is very high. Is it because it's closer to the equator? I mean, what's the reason that accuracy?
I don't know. I have to find out. I'm not in the weather science team, but it's a good question. Yeah.
Okay.
You can connect with me and I'll find out for you.
Please.
Yeah.
Packaged goods, you know, solution as well. Then we have one utility and one retail. So if we could form 4 different groups, just, you know, by the rows, and y'all can pick one solution. If you want to do retail, you can do retail. You could just pick what you want. Retail, CPG, we have quick service restaurant, and a utility use case. CPG?
So there are a few questions here we need to fill, and then each group, one guy will come and present the case, and that's where we all will discuss.
Maybe we just split the team into, you know, different areas, so you can just move around if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for your help.
Quick service, I mean, for people who are not familiar, it's like your cafe coffee day, or, you know, those are quick serve. McDonald's.
This group needs a distribute for
that. I'm going to leave the data sets here, so if you want, you can think about using them. And Manish, who's here, is also a meteorologist. He can answer questions for you.
everybody, and you can sit and have a discussion. We'll there's a breakout for 15 minutes. Okay, so for this 15 minutes time, you all can huddle, have a discussion. Then one of you can, you know, kind of come up with the findings, which we'll discuss with the team. So this is 4:15. By 4:30, we'll close the session. I'll give you a reminder call at check call at 4:25. Thank you.
Check.
Check. Check.
So, can you give a mic? What was the? Can you show me the paper? I want to see what I wrote. Can you just? Yeah. Why don't you tell what the solution
is? Yeah, I'm just checking if the voice is coming. So, our the industry which we got was the quick service restaurant company.
Okay.
And the objective was to optimize the operations. Let's think of a solution that will determine which day next week will be busier than the normal or lighter than the normal at each of the quick service restaurants. So Yeah, so what we understand is, okay, next week, we assume, suppose if this is a quick service restaurant, as in suppose this is a McDonald's or something. So the idea is to see next week when all it is going to sell, you know, higher or lower than, you know, the average. So the first thing is what kind of a weather data set can be important for this business. So what we feel is for a quick service restaurant, things which may be important is rains. Rains, when I say, number one, whether it is raining or it is not raining. Also, second thing would be the temperature. Third thing would be humidity. So these are more like the normal, you know, atmosphere. I won't like to predict cyclone or something. I mean, normal events, okay. So, yeah. So rain, I feel, should be taken hourly, because if you look at quick service restaurant, most of the people are coming in the evening or whatever it is. And suppose if it is raining some hours, it is not raining some hours, that also may impact whether the people are able to ultimately make it to the restaurant or not make it to the restaurant. So I would need an hourly forecast when it comes to rain. Temperatures, they won't make a big difference at an hour level. What may be good enough for me is to know the min, the max, and the average temperature. These three parameters would be more than, you know, enough to for me to do any kind of a prediction in terms of the turnout for the restaurant. Humidity, again, would be min, max, and average. So these are the three things which we feel are important for developing a forecasting model, at least the main ones. Now, what kind of a data from the restaurant and what granularity it is required? This is the weather data which we have talked about in terms of the restaurant. One is, you know, what is the location of the restaurant? Location will itself tell the demographics of the, you know, the kind of people who are there. So some people, you know, it's a very luxury kind of a place where most people are able to come in a car. The impact of weather may be lesser, whereas, you know, if it is, I mean, any other place where most people may be coming by public vehicles or so, the impact of a weather is higher. So location, demographics, and, you know, also when we are taking the data, because to make this model, we need historical data also of, you know, earlier days when what was the temperature, what was the weather and all these things, and what was the sale. We also have to consider the holidays, the working days, the festivals, because that will also, over and above the weather, that would also be an, you know, causal factor that would have impacted the actual turnaround in the restaurant. That also has to be taken. What challenges do you see operationalizing the solution? So from this, what we understood as a question is, if they have the model, two things. Number one, how can this model go wrong, assuming we have everything? So that's what I understood from the question. Secondly, even if we have this forecast, what will be our problem in using this forecast? So the first thing, when the problem that can come in the accuracy of the model is the sales of this restaurant, and even if I look at the past, you know, whatever has happened, it's not the only factor. What if a restaurant, you know, close by or something has given a discount or a promotion or a new launch or something like that, which would have, you know, attracted people towards that, or maybe now it is closed. So there are external factors also over and above weather and wherever it is, which can have impact into the sales of this restaurant. If not taken adequately, that may impact the our you know, model accuracy, is what we understand. Second thing is, even if we are able to predict, it has to be reasonably higher for a duration, because if I know tomorrow what is going to sell more or less, I may not be able to, they have that flexibility to ramp up my staff or bring up more inventory and those kind of things. Third thing, I believe, is the forecast that I get should not be a deterministic forecast. It should be something like a confidence interval or like a band, so that, you know, things which are very expensive and perishable, I may go for the lower band of the forecast, because my concern is nothing should go obsolete Correct. And that should, those kind of concerns should also be there. And will the last question is, will the solution be different for sit-down versus drive-through customers? What we believe is, drive-through customers are those who come more out of necessity. Sit-down customers are those who come more for experience. The sensitivity of the drive-through customers will be much less towards the weather. We are coming in a car, they have a necessity to take food at home, as compared to sit-down weather customers who have come more for experience and the impact of weather. There.
Thank you so much. I have a couple of quick questions for you. I mean, do I have 1 minute? Yeah. So this is awesome. First of all, you know, you pointed out some very, very interesting points, holidays, discount promotion. This is, external factors are very important. I mean, one thing is you could always bring them in, into your modeling itself. Mm-hmm. And the challenge in operational is you need the same information in real time.
Yes.
Likewise, if you use, you know, past sales in your modeling, you may need some of the lag data in your real time. The second thing I just thought is, would you prefer to have like day part data as opposed to, so in other words, I can give you aggregated temperature or rain for morning, afternoon, evening, or like 3 hours in the morning, mid-morning, mid-afternoon, etc.
Rain, I think, should come more precise.
Hourly, okay.
More precise, because suppose you look at this city also, suppose it rains only at 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock, almost regularly. Doesn't have more impact on the turnout on the restaurant as compared to suppose if happens between 7 to 9 in the evening when people are more likely to come.
Great.
So that rain, I think, is more specific.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Thank you. And I just want, I think I didn't mention that our forecast on demand is actually goes up to 14 days,
okay.
2 weeks. Yeah. I'm going to save this. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
So please corroborate whenever you want, okay? So it's a CPG company. The first question is that how should the CPG company break down their product categories to estimate the demand? And what are the criteria for such a breakdown? So I'm just giving an example of a beverage company. So the product categories could be carbonated drinks, juices, water-based, water, dairy-based products, etc. What could be the criteria? Yeah, criteria could be need-based, could be occasion-based, could be season-based, could be region-based, could be segment-based, even could be the financial, like, surprise-based. So depending on the product categories and the products within the categories, it's a combination of various types of needs that determine the whole structure. The second question is that how can weather influence the distribution planning, financial planning, manufacturing planning, and the promotion planning? So since it's a beverage, so we understand that the weather, especially the temperature, humidity, rainfall, that impact to a great extent. So whenever there's a season time, 45 days before the season time, the products are dispatched for the distributors to stock. So it has some life cycle to kind of deliver them. So that element gets into the financial planning as well, because the manufacturing also needs to take into account that certain amount should be more because it's a season time. So financial planning also takes into place that the investment comes into picture, distribution also comes into picture. So the promotional planning could be done at several levels. At one level, that's the ATL levels, definitely all these companies, they do promote their products 1.5 months before the season time. But at the individual level, as we know that whenever you walk in a particular mall and we are near to a store, we get a message that, you know, some company is giving that kind of offer. So how the temperature would help in such a case, that say I'm walking into a mall and it's 43, 44 degrees temperature. It's in northern part of the country, and there's some kind of promotions going on for Coke. Advertiser can take the opportunity of it. So that's how the temperature could impact a lot in terms of the promotion of the product. A friend of mine mentioned that the wind speed as well. Yes, the wind speed is high, then probably should not wear a wig. So that's why he's pretty clean. The third question is, what type of information from the data would be necessary to attribute sales changes? To my mind, it's temperature, humidity, rainfall. These could be the three key important variables to decide some kind of impact on the sales if it's a beverage company.
Okay.
Anything that my friends want to corroborate to it?
I just had one comment in there.
Sure.
Are different weather data sets, so in the context of consumer product companies, right, you may also want to look at seasonal data to look directionally where things will be going, you know, where the weather goes and hence where the demand would go. So you can use it kind of for demand forecasting.
Sure. So generally what we do is that we have the historical data, time series data, of covering, say, for the last 15 years. And though we have the every day's sales figure and every day's the weather-related variables to it, but when we do analysis on seasonal stuff, then, of course, we know that there are a few seasons which you need to take into account. So through our time series analysis, we do the demand forecasting, taking all the weather variables into it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Can I get your paper? Can I get your paper? Thanks.
Hi, everyone. Our team had retail as a case study. So it's a large retail company which would like to know if the sales next week will go up or down at individual stores based on their weather forecast. So the first question was, which product seems more likely to be affected by weather? So we looked at a couple of examples, concrete examples. For example, Big Basket or multi-brand retail store like More or Amazon as an e-commerce multi-brand, multi-product category vendors. So we thought that for somebody like Big Basket, perishable items obviously would be more affected, which would obviously include all the food items, fruits, vegetables. And we also looked at seasonal sales. For example, there would be more sales for example, woolen clothes in apparel or, say, umbrellas during rainy season. Seasonal food, as I already mentioned. And, for example, a multi-brand store like More would also have an electronics section, and you would have sales go up for ACs during the, warm seasons, and similarly for heaters during the winter seasons. So we thought that these are some kind of items which would be more affected by weather. The next question was, what weather data can be used to answer the question, what granularity of data will be needed? So we weren't sure what we mean by granularity here. We thought that, for example, perishable items, we would the temporal factors would be more relevant, and for seasonal sales, non-perishable items, spatial factors would be more relevant. But not very sure what it really means. But we thought that, for example, if we have to predict rain, we would which would kind of impact the life of perishable items, or it could impact the logistics. Suppose we have tied up with a third-party logistics provider to basically, move the item from the warehouse to the customer's location, and we have a vendor who takes the material on, say, two-wheelers, for example. So rain would definitely play a huge role in impacting the ability of the vendor to service. So for rains, we would need data like precipitation, humidity, temperature, and stuff like that. Right. So next one was what granularity of sales data is needed. So we thought that SKU level, lead time, cost of procuring items, vendors. Suppose you have one vendor versus multiple vendors, warehouses. These are the kind of data which we would need at a granular level. The next question was what challenges do you see operationalizing the solution? So we thought that lead time to procure may vary across products. So this could be a challenge. Then competition activity could be a challenge. For example, this is an external factor. So suppose I'm a you know, brick and mortar electronic store, and suddenly an e-commerce giant launches a heavy discounting scheme. So we wouldn't be able to, you know, really adapt to that. And we had things like different difficulty collaborating with partners. For example, suppose, as I said, suppose you have a third-party vendor and they have some issues because of the weather conditions. So it obviously impacts the way you service your clients, right? So those are some of the challenges. And then last question was, how does the analysis complexity change for online e-commerce sales? So we thought that it could be a trade-off. For example, a big e-commerce company would not really need brick and mortar retail stores. So centralized warehousing would in some ways positively impact or rather reduce the complexity by not needing to service multiple retail stores. Whereas on the other side, you have a much higher number of SKUs with an e-commerce vendor. So that would obviously negatively impact or increase the complexity of...
And you probably don't have dense data, right? It's much more spread out. That was the question on the product granularity too. So you may not have everybody going and buying a particular SKU every day. Right. Probably a SKU is bought like once in a month, you know. So if you go to the product level, you know, you may, people might buy Maggi noodles, but not specific type of Maggi noodles. Right. And if you don't have enough, you may want to aggregate higher and higher.
Right.
So same with e-commerce, it gets worse. Thank you, paper. Thank you so much. Last. Oh, I'm curious about utility. Thank you. That's a space in which, pardon me? Yeah, of course. You know, we do a lot with utility companies back there in US, and
do you mind if I use the board?
Of course.
So given the problem statement at hand that we are a utility company, what are the five big things that's expected from a utility company? Okay, we are going to note that down, and then we are going to analyze the problem and then go to land on the solution, right? So one, meet the demand.
Sure, so maybe you can write down and I'll just get started. So so as a power utility company, one of the first things is, you know, and how we, so different power companies have different composition of units. They use renewable power as well as standard thermal units and the sort. So the way weather affects a power utility company first is in terms of demand, right? Because inclement weather could mean changes in the demand consumption. So that's point number one. That's what my friend here has written. Second, it has also implications on how renewable energy is generated, right? So if you have a mix of solar units, wind power, hydro, So weather is of course a very crucial factor in power generation in that case, right? What that lends itself into is the spot prices market for power, right? Because when you understand what the demand is, right, and the way weather affects demand, and the way weather affects your own generation capability, it means you can then come up with a spot pricing model, right? Do you want to add a few things there? Yeah. I just covered spot prices. Do you want to add something there? No.
No, that's fine.
Yeah, you can continue ahead. Yeah.
So the next part is when are the operations of a utility company disrupted? When there's a cyclone, or there's a thunderstorm, or any kind of rare event, if we are one step ahead of the climate or the weather, if we can predict the rare event, we can prepare for it and we can minimize the losses for our company. So that's where predicting or preparing for a rare event comes into the picture. The next one is demand patterns based on weather. Say, today if the temperature rises by, say, 5 degrees, the power consumption would increase. At that point of time, if I can predict that the weather would increase, I can similarly create another model to predict the consumption pattern as well. And by predicting the demand pattern, I can prepare for the fulfillment of that demand. The last part is, last but not least, is maintenance. Companies spend a lot of money in maintaining their equipment, in maintaining their grid. So if you can predict the weather, you can predict the right maintenance schedule for your network. So these are the five big problems that we're going to solve. So with
one more thing that I'd like to add is weather also plays a role in slightly longer horizon contracts, and typically the power operator, right? So the authority would request for a certain commitment from every utility, right? I mean, so anybody who's generating, and so there will be multiple utilities which cater to a market, but they have to ensure that there's a minimum threshold that they meet. So again, there the weather the seasonal ones that you were referring to would be essential to make a demand and supply prediction. So
it's usually difficult solving any one of the problems, but if you're going to try to solve five problems, then there's a whole lot of data that you would require. So to solve five problems, there are like four things that we could list down or think of in terms of data problems. One is the right granularity of data. For some problems, we would require a longer term forecast, and for some we would require really granular data, say like in terms of minutes, weather prediction in terms of minutes. For some we would require data in terms of a week long forecast or a month long forecast. The next one is, even if we have weather data, we need to match it with our operation schedules, that is master data management. The next one is data availability. Say a lot of the utility companies have outdated systems. We need to bring our systems up to speed of the, say, the weather streaming service that we're taking up, and the reliability of the forecast is of paramount importance. Okay. Now, what metadata would be necessary? So as we said earlier, there are two kinds of data sets that we would require. One is a short-term forecast, the other one is a long-term forecast. The short-term forecast would be used to cater to the prediction of the spot prices, demand patterns based on weather, as well as meeting the immediate demand. Okay, the long-term forecast would be used to meet the long-term demand, the maintenance, as well as preparing for a rare event. Okay. So, in terms of short-term data, we would require features like humidity, rainfall, wind speed, what's the time factor that's required to ramp up or ramp down your electricity production. In terms of long-term forecast, yeah, we would require to fulfill our long-term cases, we would require data sets like population, your climate patterns, your industrial consumption patterns, how seasonal or how sensitive your customers or your grid is to weather changes, and that factor. And I mean, those are things that we could come up with in like 15 minutes. Any questions up until now? Or should we move ahead? No. We're still two points left. How will outage prediction be useful if provided for the next 10 days? If we can predict outages for the next 10 days, we will prepare for the backups. Well, in advance, preparing for backups at the last moment costs more. We can maintain our equipment at the right schedule, and we can ramp up and ramp down our electricity production in a cost-effective way. Okay. What horizons of predictions are most ideal? Short-term horizons, every minute at a minute level, and a long-term horizon at a daily, weekly, or a monthly level. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and please stay back. We have a very exciting presentation from our partners, SatSure, and Prateep is going to present. I think you have an exciting demo, too.
Thanks, Harini. Yes, it's working.
Prateep, we are out of time, so you have to make it really quick and fast.
It's like in 30 seconds, is it?
Yeah, 30 seconds. Oh, you really? Have 30 seconds from now. Start. And that ends. Thank you.
Okay. So, first of all, I know this is the last probably presentation of the day. So, as requested, I'll be keeping it short. This is not going to be a marketing presentation. I'm just trying to build on what Harini has already discussed, and you guys have been working on this exercise. So, we spoke about weather at length. How weather is useful, how it can be applied in different industries to drive efficiencies. What I'll be speaking about is addition of another data layer. The data layer that me and my other co-founders of this young startup, SatSure, have been playing since the age of 18, that's satellite imagery. So SatSure is a company which does integration of different data sets. And as you can see, four places, Bangalore, London, St. Gallen, Dubai, that's where we are. Our basis of the company 3 years back when we started was how could we bring in alternate data sets in financial risk management, especially in the agriculture sector. And that's where you need so much amount of data to fill in the gaps that exist there. Weather is one of the more important factors, but also what's happening on the ground exactly, knowing that, is another thing. Now, people ask us, there are so many sensors around. You have satellites, you have drones, you have IoT. There's always this perennial problem of what sensor to choose, what kind of data to generate, what kind of insights can we generate. So it depends on the problems. And we are agnostic of any sensors. We don't really care. It depends on the industry problem that we are trying to solve. And what happens with each part of the sensor is that if it's satellite, you may not be able to see the color of your leaves, but you can definitely see a very large area. And because the imaging that happens through satellites will be in more than just visible spectrum, that is red, blue, green, the electromagnetic spectrum you must have read in physics. So it happens in different parts of narrow bands of infrared. So that gives a lot of information because everything on Earth, it reflects. So that's one of the basis of using satellite data to see things that we cannot see through our eyes. Weather, you know how different industries have been using and are going to be using weather data for predictions, and it's so important for predicting sales cycle, for predicting flight, for planning flights, for planning your inventory. And then you have different other data sets that comes in from flat file data like econometric data, price and all. So it creates a lot of incoherent data sets for which you need to work on the Hadoop, MapR kind of frameworks. And that's not the end of it. The problem is how to make sense of it. And in the next whatever time I have left, I'm seeing it, 3 minutes, I'll just take you through what we have been doing. So in agriculture domain, some of the key questions that people want to know is what is growing, where is it growing, and how much is it growing? These are the three questions. Now, without going to the field, how can we identify what is the crop? As I said before, we have each and every object and each and every plant having different reflectance properties. Throughout the growth stage of the plant, we have been capturing these different indices of band combination, made of band combinations, and creating the training data of which crop it belongs to, whether it's maize or paddy or ragi. And then the question arises for any data scientist, accuracy kitna hai be? Right? So let me tell you, it varies. It can never be a globally accurate information set. But we have seen 98.9%. We have seen 67% also, which is good. So things like monitoring the crops. Monitoring means not just over space, but over time. Over time, how frequently can you do it? Can you do it in a week? Can you do it every day? So these are the questions which are client dependent. A commodities guy may want to know it every day for trading, while an insurance client may just want to know before the crop is going to be harvested. A banking client may want to know before the crop is sown in this kind of problems area. And beyond agriculture, there is also a lot of information where satellites and weather data are integrated. For example, what you see here is one of the dashboards where we are estimating which are the best rooftops to target as for generating the maximum solar power with a condition that there is a 2x2 meter solar panel. So by extracting the footprints of the rooftops using high resolution satellite data, overlaying it on a simple map, basically dumbing it down for the guys to use it, and using the irradiance data from satellites, getting the shadowing using the elevation models generated using satellites, we are telling out of, let's say, 1 million houses in a city, which are the 50,000 best ones, so reducing the cost of acquisition of customer. Second, we are telling what is the best angle at which you can install the solar panel for maximum energy production throughout the year, because it's not the same, right? Thank you. Usually that's the speed, but since I waited for an hour, so I'm going to take my sweet time.
No issues. It's the last hour, so a few more minutes we can go ahead with. Right. But we have a very good show waiting for all of you.
Show?
Yeah, very nice show. Like a stand-up comedy. Yeah, this is more important, obviously, so that's why I'm giving him the time. It's okay. It's a leisure time.
No, it's fine. You just made your choice clear. Stand-up comedy over satellites.
No.
It's okay.
You can go ahead.
So, I'll basically show a demo where we collaborated with IBM recently. You must have all heard about the Kerala floods, right? So IBM and us put together a portal within 48 hours of, as you call, pardon my language, shit going down there. A lot of people were in distress. I studied in Kerala. All my co-founders, we studied in Kerala. So we have a connection there. What you're seeing here is snapshots. I'm going to show you a live demo. And with that, I'll end. Thank you. I'm hoping that the internet connection at Radisson Blue is good. So this essentially will show how both these data sets together form what we call as decision intelligence frameworks. Well, the internet speed is not great, but let us see what we can do. So here, we took radar satellite data, because during the time when it was raining heavily, you can't see through optical satellites. But there are different satellites which are called radar satellites, which can penetrate through clouds and see during night anytime. So what you see here on the color shading, that essentially shows how much area these districts, how much area is underwater. So the color shading is the demarcation for that. Now, we were sitting with the Kerala government guys, along with many other people, as volunteers, just out of our own will, no commercials. We geolocated all the calls that they were getting on the emergency helpline number. So we knew that even before processing the satellite image, that there will be some heavy damage there. The hospitals, the major spatial layers were created here so that people can see that in the areas where the maximum number of rescue calls are coming, which are the best hospitals, so you can just zoom in and see which hospitals are these also. And yeah, well, yeah, it's coming fine now. Then the interesting part starts happening while you are looking at what's the flooding extent. Now, this flooding extent is where our satellite magic comes into picture. So you will see there are two layers. One layer is 14th August, one layer is 21st August. So as soon as I switched on this layer, you can see this is the natural water bodies, and then you switched on, this is the amount of flooding that has happened. And this, when you start zooming out of it, this map, it's a big blob of blue. Okay, so just to show you the problem, how it extended, I will switch on the layer of 21st, which is again another satellite image processed. And you will see further how this Cochin airport got further flooded. So we were continuously monitoring this situation, not just this, but also the estimated height, depth, because there will be certain places where the depth of water was increasing. So this is created by taking the sloping features into consideration, so that you can then prioritize which areas to fly your helicopters for the search and rescue. Just 2 weeks back, a lot of people were felicitated by Kerala government, including us, and also I think IBM. So the rainfall data, which was integrated, continuously kept showing, for example, if you have certain amount of flooding, certain depth of flooding, current rainfall statistics and forecasted rainfall statistics, which area has a high future risk, which area is under high current risk, and which areas have already been damaged by the historic. Everything was being covered by just two data sets, weather, satellite, and statistics to be published soon. 17,000 people were rescued using this. So that's the reason we were felicitated with this island. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, speakers. Thank you, ma'am, so much. Thank you for the t-shirts. Everyone can give a round of applause instead of the t-shirt. If you haven't got your particular size, please exchange with me. We have a good show waiting for all of you there. And also, our dinner at 7 o'clock will be served downstairs. So thank you so much. It was a lovely day. And all the best for tomorrow. I'll see you tomorrow again. Thank you. Thank you.